Okay, so good morning or good afternoon, everybody. Today we have the talk from Alberto del Moral. I think that Isabella asked me to do the introduction, and also I will chair the session at the end because she is not feeling very well. So Isabella, I hope that you will recover soon. And then what I'm going to do is to start with a presentation of it's a brief presentation of Alberto, and then he will make the speech. Okay. So Alberto, he's part of one of the group of people working at CNM that lives in Sabadell, which is something relevant, I will say. Alberto got the degree on physics by the Autonomous University of Barcelona in 2016. And then he went to the University of Barcelona to do the master on nanoscience and nanotechnology during 2016 and 17. And in October 2017, he joined the CNM to do his PhD, which took place in the framework of the European project Ions for SET, that actually started the project in February 2016. And this project has ended just a few months ago, right? Then Alberto, together with Esteve Amat, will say, have been fully and very intensively working in this Ion for SET project during all these years. And I'm pretty sure that they will not forget this project for the rest of their lives. As you will see from his presentation, pulling ahead the Ion for SET project has been extremely demanding. It has required a very intensive clean room work, most of it in the self-operation mode, but also involving many areas of the clean room. I mean, we have even including the fabrication of CMOS devices. And also it has meant a lot of meetings and coordination with the rest of partners of the project. And just to give you an example, we have had for 2 years, every Friday, weekly meetings with all the partners, more than 1 hour every Friday morning. And I think that I have to acknowledge here Alberto and Esteve for all their commitment, all the effort to bring or to put ahead the Ion for SET project. Also, I think it's worth to mention that the COVID-19 pandemic has had an important impact in the final part of the work, both of the thesis and of the project. But also on the thesis, it has added difficulties to the experimental part, also for the collaboration with the partners. And I think that you will notice also this in the presentation, right? But in any case, I think that the overall result of the project is positive. Alberto has learned a lot on clean room process. He has got a lot of experience. He has generated new knowledge for the clean room, for the center. He together with Esteve Escor, and I hope that now Alberto, he will be able to use this experience in his new professional phase that that will start on September. Today he's going to talk about single electron devices, which I think is a rather new topic here at CNM, but maybe it will be a more let's say common topic in next years. And well, Alberto, the screen is yours.
Okay, thank you for the introduction. Well, I will talk today about the integration of vertical single electron transistor into CMOS technology. I think that you see the pointer, no? Well, yes. Okay. The basic scaling has driven in semiconductor industry a continuous progress with the consequent impact on society. First, it was done by means of reducing the base dimensions of the transistors, but a few years ago it started to gain importance the fact of implementing new configurations, for instance, the either lateral or vertical devices. Two of the main applications that derived from this aspect were the Internet of Things and quantum computing. First, well, the Internet of Things represents a network with an increasing number of components, which in turn requires of new methods or strategies to keep reasonable levels of power consumption. The second application, quantum computing, benefits from this application by fabrication semiconductor qubits. And one example is in this context, the is to demonstrate the manufacturability of a single electron transistor in a vertical, and also its CMOS compatibility. And this is what we will see in this presentation. Okay. The devices carrying that I was mentioning before can also be graphically represented. As you can see here, this is the evolution of semiconductor industry by means of technology node and transistor, number of transistors per microprocessor. And the main fact at the beginning, keeping updated this technological trend was a question of scaling rules, of keeping some scaling rules, so reducing the transistor size. But around 20 years ago, another aspect started to gain importance, mainly regarding the configuration of the architecture of the transistor. I cannot pass the slide, I don't know why. Give me 1 minute because PowerPoint is not responding. Okay, I hope that you can see the slide again, right?
Yes, 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 okay. We can see the slide.
I was saying that recently the point was to implement different architectures. And one example of this is the building 3D channels, either vertically or lateral, and relevant devices that have proved represented an improvement is the FinFET or the gate-all-around FinFET or the gate-all-around FET. No.
Okay, it's happening again, right?
Well, it is not the connection in this case, but the PowerPoint by itself, yeah, which is not responding.
Good that it happens today and not on Wednesday.
Yeah, that's a good point. Maybe you can use my computer or another computer, Alberto.
I'm opening also in PDF, which I guess that would be easier.
Oh yeah. You're open now in PowerPoint, no?
Eh?
Okay. No, that what you have in the screen is the PowerPoint, it's not a PDF.
Yes, because it has opened automatically.
Okay.
I will try one last time, the PowerPoint. If not, I have the PDF. Okay. Okay. In this presentation, we will see a brief introduction of the integration of a vertical SET into CMOS technology, and finally conclusions. Well, single electronics is based on the control and transport of single or small number of electrons. A good way to approximate the concept is starting from the two leads separated by electric.
Alberto. Now the voice is not, I mean, there is like the connection is not good because we cannot hear properly the voice.
You know what I mean? That's great. Then maybe I will go to my computer and I don't know.
Well, try again. Maybe it's solved now.
Okay.
But
stop me again if it happens again, okay?
Yeah.
Expression.
Yeah, Alberto, it's happening.
Okay. It's happening.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Then give me 1 minute, I will go to my computer.
Okay. So I...
Oof, okay. Share a slide. Now you can hear me and you can see the screen.
Yes.
Okay. I think that everything will go fine now.
Yes. Okay. Much better now.
Okay. I was saying an approximation is the planar capacitor. Okay. Then in this configuration we have a capacitance which is the expression of the charge among the plates by the difference of tension among them. Then the amount of charge that of energy that we need to implement to the system in order to transfer one charge to another plate, it has the second expression. After integration into the interval of the plates, we have the third one. And finally, given a nanoscale capacitor with a certain charge on the plates, in order to, well, the energy that we need to implement to the system to transfer one single electron has this final expression, okay? In this context, the ideal configuration for building the channel is a quantum dot. A quantum dot is essentially a nanoscale metallic or semiconductor particle, in which given the low dimensions of the particle, we have the discretized level of energies. And also, by applying a voltage along the particle, we can modify, we can shift above or below these energy levels. A single electron transistor is essentially a quantum dot in which a gate action is provided. In other words, by modeling the gate bias, we can tune electrons from source to drain. Among the characteristics of the SCT, it is important to note that electron tunneling happens at discrete levels of voltage. So when we plot drain current versus drain bias, we observe this step-like structure, which represents the tunneling of electrons. A second characteristic is that the application of a gate bias helps to shift the energy levels of the island. And in that way, electrons tunnel from source to island and from island to drain. And a third characteristic is a result of the previous ones. When a certain drain bias is applied, then the drain current becomes extremely sensitive to gate bias. So we obtain, when we plot the drain versus the gate bias, these rhomboid shapes, which is named diamond plot, which is very representative of the SCT device. Well, most of the current state of the SCTs in the state of the art are fabricated either planar or in lateral configurations. Usually, most of them are not CMOS compatible and thus represent have scalability issues. And also, it is common that these types of devices require low temperature in order to operate. And the Ions for Set proposal combines these two configurations. First, it combines the SCT circuit with a vertical arrangement in the form of nano pillar. It aims to be CMOS compatible and also scalable, and also it aims to be room temperature operable. And how? The strategy to do so is based on the patterning of a sandwich silicon oxide silicon nanopillar with a silicon nanocrystal on the oxide layer induced by self-assembly process. In this configuration, we need nanodots on the order of 3 nanometer with tunnel junctions of 1.5 and diameters very thin, on the order of 10 to 50 nanometers. Okay, now we are going to see how to implant these nanodots on the oxide layer. It is a combination of a two-step process. So first, ion irradiation, which produces a far from equilibrium phase on the oxide layer. So silicon is implanted, and some volumes of this oxide layer turns into a COX metastable form. And also, then, by rapid thermal annealing, there is a phase separation of these volumes, and this COX metastable form separates into silicon and silicon oxide. In this, this is a question of annealing time and annealing temperature. It is important to mention here that after silicon anode formation, temperatures above 900 degrees might lead to silicon anode dissolution. So it is a constraint that we have to have in mind. It is a self-assembly method. So in this case, you can see the silicon anodes on the oxide layer between the two silicon layers. And it is important to note here that in order to have just one silicon nanodot, we need a geometrical constraint, which is given by diameters on the order of 10 nanometer of diameter. Okay, this is the complete sequence for pillar patterning and silicon nanodot self-assembly. Note that the process that are part of the silicon nanodot self-assembly, the ion irradiation and the rapid thermal annealing, are separated by the pillar patterning. This is because the ion irradiation on the pillar structure may induce some damage on the pillar. So the final sequence is first stack preparation, then ion irradiation on this stack, pillar patterning by means of electron beam lithography and reactive ion etching. So here you can see some tilted SEM views of the nanopillars. Then RTA with the conditions that we saw before. And finally, a sequence of plasma oxidation followed by HF wet etching in order first to reduce the dimensions of the pillar and also while generating a thin silicon oxide around the pillar. So we already have the pillar with the dimensions on the order of 70 nanometer high and from 10 to 50 nanometers wide. And we need to turn this into a functional device. So we need to place in a planar arrangement on vertical a gate electrode around the pillar, a source electrode on contact with the bulk, and a drain electrode in contact with the cap of the pillar. There are some challenging issues here that we have to consider. First, we need an oxide around the nanopillar, very thin. We need the gate electrode all around the nanopillar and aligned with the oxide intermediate oxide layer. We need a drain on top of the pillar. And of course, an effective drain gate separation. This is the schematic representation of the overall process that we have developed from the pillar pattern, the pattern nanopillar to the fully contacted device. This has been the key part of our role in the project, the design, optimization, and development of the full process sequence. It includes more than 40 individual steps. Many of these processes had to be developed from scratch, and also it is important to remark here that most of them require a time characterization, so the process monitoring was essential. The first part, well, the first step was to perform a diluted wet etching in order to turn this 5-6 nanometer paraffin oxide into a 2-3 nanometer layer. Then, is the creation of insulating intermetal layers. This is done, this is one of the processes that we had to develop from scratch. First, we deposit an inorganic resist. Then we etch back this layer down to the level that we want. And we turn this layer into an oxide form by means of thermal annealing. And here you have an FEM profile of the nanopillar. As you can see,
half of the pillar is covered by this layer, leaving completely uncovered the pillar cap. The local removal of this oxide layer from top of the pillar was also a key issue. And it had, the only way to perform this was to use the argon plasma before the sputtering, the titanium nitride sputtering, to etch this oxide from top of the pillar. And in this time, you can see a 50 nanometer pillar with the oxide layer, first with the nanodots on the emitted oxide, and with the titanium nitride on top of the pillar in contact with the pillar. So there is no silicon oxide that separates the device from the layer. Then, for grid definition, we follow this sequence. First, the deposition of an HSQ layer as a negative mask. Then the edge pack of this mask leaving uncovered the cap of the pillar. And then the titanium nitride wet etching in order to remove it from top of the pillar and from outside the gate region. And also, it is important to mention again that the monitoring of this sequence was very important to validate the process. The same method that we used for the first intermetal layer is used for the second one. In this case, you have 10 figures of the smaller of the pillars and the largest. In both cases, the titanium nitride is removed from top of the pillar, as you can see. It is aligned with the intermediate oxide layer, and also the intermetal layers are on the order that we need. Then, in this point, the drain definition can be fabricated. Again, temp characterization is essential to prove the process. Well, first you have a same top view of the device. Here we have 5 very small pillars that we cannot even see. The bottom electrode is the gate, the upper one is the drain, and this is the metal routing on contact with the pre-metals. And regarding the time analysis, we can see that the titanium nitride is completely removed from top of the pillar. It's aligned with the oxide again, and the drain is in contact with the pillar cap. And it is important also that we have thin but effective separation between gate and drain. So the result is that the pillar is fully contacted from structural analysis. Now we need some measurements that can be attributed to the presence of silicon nanodots. So these measurements were done at CNR in Milano. And the first structure that we are going to see is the preliminary structure before the fully integrated pillar that was fabricated at the beginning of the project. It is a pseudo pillar, so we don't have the base of the pillar, and then we don't have also a gate electrode. But anyway, these measurements, in these first measurements, we can see that we have conductance peaks at low temperature in this regime. This oscillation is also visible at almost room temperature, and it is correlated with the simulations performed in this type of configuration. So, and it is also not measured in any of the non-implanted samples. So it is attributed to the silicon nanodot. Okay. Almost. Regarding the fully contacted pillars, the figure from this first figure shows the correct characteristic of a fully integrated pillar. You can see some steps or oscillations in the low temperature measurements, the blue one. And these steps are also observed when we plot the conductance. And this is also a characteristic of the single of the quantum dot. Well, as complement for these measurements, it is convenient to take a look to the SET model that the project partners of Fraunhofer have developed. This is basically a model that allows us to modify some characteristic of the device. For instance, the quantum dot size, the oxide thickness, and the pillar diameter. And it is important because we see that, well, we need quantum dots below 3 nanometers in order to observe these oscillations. But when this nanodot is smaller than 2 nanometers, then the oscillations are only found to very to high number of to high values of voltages. And it happens something similar when the, with the pillar, the pillar diameter. If we have a pillar of 10 nanometers, we can observe the oscillations, but if the pillar is of 14 or 15 nanometers, then the oscillation is very, very soft. I'm trying to pass the slide, but again, there is some problems. No, you're on the same slide. Yes, yes, I know. But this is the only way to see the slide. Okay, I will follow. We have seen the SIC integration process. It was important to demonstrate that this process is CMOS compatible. So we have to develop all this compatibility test in form of an hybrid SCT-FET demonstrator. So we have the SCT in the pillar configuration that we have seen and connected to a planar transistor. The benefit, the main advantage of this configuration is that the SCT stands for low power consumption, while the CMOS maturity provides stability. And also, there is some constraints. For instance, as I mentioned, the thermal process is above 900 degrees damage the SCT configuration. On the other hand, standard CMOS processing with many processes above this thermal budget. The FET has to operate at a low threshold voltage, and also fabricating a 3-micron FET at the same level that a 30-nanometer pillar, of course, compromises the SCT integrity. Okay, the sequence is depicted here. The pillar pattern was done at CLT at 8 inches wafer. We needed a wafer reshaping down to 4 inches wafer. It was done at an external company, but the integrity of the pillar had to be proved after reshaping. Then, a silicon nitride layer of 300 nanometers was deposited by PCBD as protection for the pillars during the FET fabrication. Okay. And then the FET is fabricated with processes pre-optimized to the thermal budget. After FET fabrication, the pillar is uncovered, and it is validated again the integrity by FEM. Then sacrificial oxidation, as we saw at the beginning. Then the SCT integration takes place, as we have seen in the previous slides. And finally, the SCT-FET integration interconnection takes place either by optical or electron beam lithography. Okay, and conclusions. We can separate conclusions into types. Regarding the integration of the vertical SCT, we have demonstrated the full contacting of a vertical nanopillar by structural analysis. Also, we have measurements that are attributed to the presence of silicon nanodots. And in the process, we have developed many processes that also add value to the project. No, and the second type of conclusions is that the compatibility of the SCT with CMOS has been proved again by TEM analysis. The CMOS processes have been adapted to the SCT requirements, and at the end we have fabricated at the same level a 3-micron transistor that operates at optimum conditions for the SCT integration, while preserving the pillar and the silicon nanodot integrity. And in this point, finally, I have to mention that the two projects that have funded this work are the Ions for Set and the Starset project. As you have seen, many of the projects have been developed in the clean room of the institute. So also this is part of their work. And finally, thank you all for the attention, and sorry for all the inconvenience that we have had. You still there?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Alberto. And don't worry about these problems. I mean, I don't know how to say in English, pero son cosas del directo.
Vale.
So don't worry. Okay. So I think that you appreciated the amount of work behind this project and also about his thesis. And now, I mean, if there is any question, you are welcome to open your microphone and do a question.
Hello, this is Luis. Just Albert, one Hi. Curiosity. How sure are you that the quantum dots will form in the pillars? Or there are some cases where you don't have any quantum dot in the pillar because, you know, or if you have more than one, are you able to differentiate these situations after with the measurements, or is it a problem?
I will try to move the slides, although it may be a little bit dangerous, but it is true that the quantum dot formation was not an easy thing to achieve. And also we were not in any case completely sure that it was formed in the middle of the nanopillar. Anyway, it also has to be mentioned that the fact of having several nanodots, it did not compromise the SIT integration because we have proved by simulations that there is a preference for the largest one. So if we have at least one nanodot, let's say of 3 nanometer, it is okay. If we have more, it is not a real problem.
And what about the temperature? The temperature. In the end, did you think that these devices will work at close to room temperature?
Well, we have measurements of some oscillations at room temperature. It is true that we don't have the functional device. It is true, but we have these measurements that, well, there is oscillations that are proved to are similar to the simulations, but I don't know the exact temperature, but this oscillation is visible at almost room temperature. We don't have the functional device, but we at least have this type of indications that the structure is visible.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Okay. All right. Well, while waiting for additional questions, maybe I have one.
Okay.
Alberto, you showed the overall process for the fabrication of the SET. So, and this is the process that we defined more or less at the beginning, and then we changed some steps, but basically the process was followed from the beginning of the project, or the beginning that we started working in this aspect until the end, right? But if you will have to start again now from the very scratch, will you change something or will you follow a different approach?
Yes. One of the main issues that have been a real constraint during all this project is the fact that we have almost barely 20, 25 nanometers to place first the gate electrode and then the drain electrode. So we have only, let's say, a margin of error of 5 nanometers for this separation. If we had, instead of this configuration, a larger upper part of the pillar, like the base, this is almost, well, 40 nanometers, this is 25. If we had 40 nanometers of pillar, then we will be able to place these two electrodes with much more reliability.
Okay, thank you. There is a hand.
Yes, this is Jaume.
Okay, Jaume. Yes.
Thank you for this very interesting presentation, and the process is very complex, and the results is very good. I think it's very interesting. I have two curiosities. One is respect to the process. Why did you choose these conductive materials as titanium nitride and nickel as a contact for the for the amorphous silicon? And the other question is about the TEM image. Where did you do the image, and how do you prepare the samples to find the pillar? The
Well, regarding the second question, the TEM was performed at XZR. I didn't mention that, but it is important to mention, because it was really very helpful to have all this TEM characterization. They were a partner of the project, so their role was basically helping with the integration in that way. And regarding the first question, the choice of having titanium nitride as gate and nickel as drain was basically based on literature. I mean, we had bibliography that the nickel was a good ohmic contact with the silicon, and also the titanium nitride is really helpful in these quantum dot based devices. I think that regarding the conductivity and the diffusion. I mean, I am not sure about why, but many of the quantum dot based devices use titanium nitride.
Yeah, may I comment on this also? The titanium nitride was also a suggestion from one person from the industrial board of the project, because this is used in the semiconductor industry when you have to have very thin layers of metal. I mean, the thickness of the gate electrode of this titanium nitride was only 8 nanometers, and then you have to deposit a metal which will be conductive and also will not oxidize during the processing or after the processing, and also it will have a good conductivity. And then the choices were not that much, and then he suggested titanium nitride, and then this worked pretty well. And also, as Alberto said, later on we discovered that for all these quantum technologies, also titanium nitride is quite used as an electrode for the semiconductor qubit. So this is the process that was developed in the clean room for the sputtering of titanium nitride. This is something that also is going to be further developed in next projects, I think.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. All right. I think that the there are not more questions. And of course, you are all invited to the thesis, to the presentation thesis of Alberto, which will be on July 14 at 11. And also, I think that I will conclude here. This is just the last talk of this Friday talks, but there are still three theses, I think, in program and before summer vacation. So it's the one from Eduard Masvidal, the one from Alberto, and there is another more which will take place before the summer vacation. So still there are three talks, I think, to be presented. So thank you very much to all.